Hi, Miss Marilyn. How are you doing today?
I'm doing okay. Hanging in there.
Hanging
in? As they say, one day at a time.
Well, this particular day is Mother's Day.
Yes.
I don't think I even got a chance to say Happy Mother's Day to you officially.
Okay.
So, Happy Mother's Day.
Okay, I thank you. And
I just want to say something real quick. Miss Marilyn is like sort of like my adoptee mother right now. She's been bringing food over to the farmhouse every day, making sure that we're all fed. And first of all, thank you. We really appreciate that.
You're welcome.
I want you to tell us a little bit about your history with this farm. How did this come to be? I know it's a seventh generation family farm, right?
Yes, and I also grew up on a farm. So the farm has been most of my life since I was 10 and a half years old. And then I met my husband when I was a senior in high school. And 2 years later, which would make it 1957, I'm like an antique, an oldie but goodie, right? And anyway...
Not that old, though. How old are you?
Oh, I don't admit to those numbers anymore. Because I sometimes think numbers are not accurate. Okay. So in 1957, we got married. So this, my husband's family farm, the Rickey farm, has been my whole adult life. And I wasn't just the farmer's wife. There were times when I was working alongside of him. And then we still had his father, which was my father-in-law. And there were a good many times during the summer when they were making hay that I would drive the tractor or I would drive the truck. And basically my husband and my father-in-law, who was still able at that time, they loaded the bales on the hay and on the wagon, and then we came back to the barn. And at that time we had what they call a hay elevator that is still here on the farm. And my husband and father-in-law would unload that, and that was when I got a little bit of a break in between the driving, was because they did the loading, the unloading, and then mounted away up in the top of the barn, which we now are using for this huge, humongous barn sale from a lot of good donations that people have really been forthcoming and donating and really trying to help this family farm stay in existence.
So I want to touch on something. I've heard you say a lot, this idea of being a farmer's wife. But as I've come to know you, the term farmer's wife seems so passive, like almost like the farmer is the one, you know, in control, doing the work, and the farmer's wife is, you know, when we hear it initially, it sounds like a very passive thing. But as I've gotten to know you, I can clearly see that the role you play is not a passive role at all. So I just want to make that astronomically clear.
It's been very active and very physical in that. But see, I was programmed to that growing up on a farm. And I knew how that it's 7 days a week, every day. There really are no weekends off, no holidays off, especially if you have the cows. And that's what we were. We were a dairy farm. I grew up on a dairy farm, and this was always a dairy farm until the past several years. But it's very busy, very active. This, I just said recently, is part of the reason I never needed a membership to a gym, because I do my own yard work. I mean, I still do most of my yard work. I do get a little help now and then when it's really needed and necessary from my son and his helpers. But, you know, thank God that I pretty much can still do what I've known and done my whole life.
That's a beautiful, beautiful thing. You can see the smile that you're bringing to my face, because I think that you are such a shining example of vitality. And this farm has had vitality through its history because you've been tending to it. And right now, what's happening that, you know, is affecting your ability to tend to the farm? What's going on right now?
Well, years ago, when my husband was diagnosed with cancer, and it's coming up on 19 years now this year in August that we actually lost him. So it was almost 24, 25 years that we went through a really, really difficult time from the time he was diagnosed and the treatment. And during that time, my son Jamie, who is the seventh generation in the Rickey family, took over the farming. We still had the cows, and he kept numbers, accurate numbers. We were actually at that time, we also on our property up at the base of the mountain, we had some sand and gravel, and our neighbor contracted with my husband and father-in-law to take out some of that gravel. And so we were all making money from the sand and gravel, not associated with actually the farm, milking and all of that at that time. But what the numbers showed that my son Jamie was keeping was that we were actually putting more money in most of the time, most months, than we were getting back from the farming operation. So eventually we decided that it was time for the cows to go. We actually were a small dairy farm. We were, you know, and over the years, most businesses have grown, and that includes the dairy farm. Bigger numbers, more cows, more acreage and land to work. And we sort of just decided at that time that it was time for the cows to go and for us to gradually get into something else in order to keep this family farm. So then once we lost my husband and things were really getting tight and difficult, and my son was to inherit the family farm. That was my husband's plan, and so we've tried to do that. Jamie and I talked after losing my husband that, yes, we did want to try and hopefully be able to hold on to this family farm. And at that time, the house that my husband and I had built on the 2 acres adjoining the farmland was built, and we paid it all off, the mortgage. Everything was all paid off in less years than we had taken it out for.
So it sounds like you had some fiscal responsibility there. You know, it was like you were being a responsible landowner. And then the economy crashed?
And then, yes, and then after we lost, like I said, after we lost him, then the economy started going the other way, and it was getting just really, really difficult with the whole farm, paying the taxes, paying the monthly bills. And so then Jamie just, and I, you know, we sat talking about it, and he said, we need to remortgage your house. And this is only a bridge to get us into a better place financially. And hopefully the economy and just things in general, we're going to start turning around and be more positive. For some reason, that has not happened. So after we had remortgaged my house with Chase, which was a number of years ago, probably about 8, I'm not 100% sure. You know, we were able in the beginning to make a few payments, but then we just weren't in a place that we could afford to pay that mortgage anymore. So, you know, it became delinquent. So right now Chase is to the point where they want their money or they want to put me out of my home, which my husband and I built, and the only home I've really known my whole adult life. I've raised 2 children there. It's my life. Without my home, I don't have a life. And it still is tied. It's separate, but it still is tied to the farm property. And I've always been a part of the farm life and the farm activities here. And it's a very insecure, difficult place to find myself in after my whole life. I have worked on the farm, and I've worked for my home, and I'm still working at it. and I don't want to lose it.
Well, I'm going to take my sunglasses off because your story is honestly bringing me to tears. And I think one of the really important messages here is that Miss Marilyn, who we all consider mom, has worked her entire life. This farm has been her life. She's been working day in and day out for her family, for the community, for health and well-being, and, you know, essentially to no fault of your own or of the family.
And the sad part is, too, the family farm. I mean, how many family farms do we have left in our country anymore?
Right.
We are losing so many each year. And they always have been, and they still should be, the backbone of our country. And yet, it's like we're getting pushed by the wayside. You're out of here. They build the McMansions, and put down the cement and the blacktop, and your farm and your open space is gone. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. We already have more of all those things than we need.
And what are we losing when we lose the farm? We're not just losing a piece of land. We're losing everything that family and that caring of the land can produce. I mean, one of the driving forces that drove me to come stay at the farm was sharing the land, sharing God's love through sharing the land. So it's this idea of sharing, right? And Miss Marilyn has shared her love as a farmer's wife with her husband, with her son, with the community at large, with me. She's opened up her doors to me, to many, many travelers who have come through. I've met so many beautiful people just in my time here. I've only been here for a month. And family farms are a way to not only feed people physically, but to feed our souls. They're a way to feed our values of family. And that's what Miss Marilyn proves here, is that, you know, she's put her husband and her son and this farm and this family in Vernon, New Jersey first, over and over and over and over. And now it's time for you guys to put the farm first.
Yeah. And anyway, like I said, we had to make some changes with the farm years ago. And Jamie always has been musically inclined and enjoyed the live bands, which is what those are what we feature here. He has created a venue where we have events scheduled.
This is
spring,
huge.
Summer, and fall. And the first one right now, I think coming up, our first event, I think, is May 21st. It's a wedding. And we look forward to that. And then the following weekend is another, which I understand is a big event that is, you know, they've already sold a bunch of tickets on the internet. We look forward to that. And I enjoy those things. I usually go up, welcome everyone, the new vendors, the new bands that maybe I haven't met the previous year, but I put in my appearance, I put in my time. Sometimes it gets a little loud for me, gets a little busy for me. I take my break and I come back down to the farm, because these events take place up above our farm at the base of the mountain. If you drive up this incline behind the main barn, you come to the base of the mountain, and there's this nice plateau that levels off, and it's beautiful. Jamie and some friends have built a stage up there where the bands appear and give of their time and their talent. And it's something I already this season look forward to.
Yeah, there's a lot of bands, like she said, bands, vendors, people in the community giving of their time and their talent here to Rickey Farm, and Rickey Farm giving right back to them. And we want to make that exchange, that interdependence, grow beyond just this local community. this venue here is amazing. So not only is the farm doing food production, but it is also a hub of art, creativity, freedom of expression. It is a home for, like I said, travelers seeking refuge. It is an exchange of goods for people to eliminate waste, because we all know that some people's treasures or some people's trash is other people's treasures. And so we really have what we think is a portal for miracles here. And if you check out our campaign, the Rickey Farm Rescue Miracles in a Making, you'll be able to see even more of all the wonderful miracles. We have, like I said, food production, live events. We've got a maple product line coming out. And behind the scenes, behind that all, is Mother Earth giving to Miss Marilyn to give to us. So it's a cycle. This is the cycle of life. And Miss Marilyn, you've just been such a blessing, such a spirit, such an energy on this farm. And I feel your energy in this ground, in this earth, in the farmhouse. And it would be an absolute travesty to see this operation take a foreclosure. So please, if you're watching this video, get to know Miss Marilyn a little bit better. We're going to be having a little Miss Marilyn's words of wisdom coming up. Because, you know, we all know we don't always listen to our mothers, but I think today is the time that we need to listen to the wisdom of Mother Earth, of Mother Marilyn, and rescue this farm. So take a look, follow us, take a look at the campaign link below. And we're really actually also calling out to Chase Bank in this endeavor. Chase Bank is the one that you've been working with financing the home, right?
Right, yes, exactly.
Okay, I'm also a client of Chase Bank, and you know what? We know that Chase has done so much and continues to do so much for the community. And as I said, what a travesty it would be to lose this farm. And what an opportunity it would be for Chase to really step in and give back to the community in this way.
That somehow there might be a way that we can work with Chase in reference to the farm and all of this, and it could benefit all of us in such a big, positive way. And like I said, this has always been my life. I want this now at my age to continue to be my life.
And I think I'm going to point out what you said there, which is that this can be a benefit to us all.
Yes.
So much of the way we function in today's society is on, well, what am I losing from this? What am I losing? What am I gaining? What am I losing? What am I gaining? When really on a farm, in a community operation like a farm, like a family farm in particular,
right,
that's not the way we make decisions here on the farm. The decision making doesn't come from what's in it for me. It comes from how can I help others? What's in it for us? How can we all benefit? How can we get together and work together to create positivity, health, wellness, exercise, fun, creativity for everyone involved? And it doesn't have to be that anyone loses. We can all win in this.
And I think when we're talking family farms, it's something to do with actually loving the ground, loving the soil. You have to love where you're at and what you're doing, because like I'm saying, it's a lot of hard work most days.
Yeah.
And
you know that toil much more than I do.
I'm so programmed to all of that, I don't know any different. And if some days, at the end of the day, I don't like feeling that I wasted any time. That there was something that I could have done or something I should have done, and for some reason, I didn't do it. I didn't get it done. But this too, like I said, when I was a child, growing up on the farm, I was the oldest of seven children when we moved on the farm at 10 and a half. And prior to that, we lived in a small bungalow, and my father worked at the railroad shops in Middletown.
I know Middletown.
But mind you, my father and my mother both, back in those days, both grew up on family farms. So, but anyway, he had been working for a bunch of years at the railroad shops, and I can still remember him coming in all covered with soot, really dirty. I believe he was some type of a mechanic that actually worked on the trains. So then one day he just decided that he didn't care to do that anymore, and it might not be that healthy, that he wanted to go back farming and do what he had learned growing up as a youngster. So that's when we leased a farm just across the state line into Warwick, New York. And we farmed there until he was killed. It was a drinking and driving accident. And so he was only 45 years old. I had just been married like 2 years, 2.5 years, I think it was. And he was killed, you know. And but I'm saying the farm life is really the only kind of life I've ever known my whole life. And
it's going to continue to be the life you know, because we're not going to let you down, and the community is not going to let you down, and Chase Bank is not going to let you down, and the government's not going to let you down, because you've worked extremely hard for this, and it's time that we work extremely hard for you to make sure that we get your house saved.
And believing in what we're doing. Believing in what we're doing is the right thing. Like I said, it's been difficult, and it's been a bunch of sacrifices up to this point. But it's what we believe, and it just brings that saying to me that I grew up with, probably hearing my mother and my grandmother say.
Tell me, I'm so excited.
That God helps those who help themselves. And I have to say, my son is so big on the faith, which is a good thing, because at times I needed that boost that I got from him, from just the way he would talk. And say, thank you, God. But there are so many times I can get off my John Deere mower after I've cut all my grass. The first thing I say before I get off is, thank you, God.
It all definitely starts with gratitude.
But then there's a bunch of other names. I mean, my son helps me, keeps gas in it for me. My brother does the mechanical part. So when I get on it and I hit start, it's working.
Kind of like gears, right? Kind of like different parts of a gear to make an entire machine work. The farm operation is like a little machine, and each person has a different role, but every role is important. And we don't want to minimize. We don't minimize here by saying, oh, well, you know, if you're the CEO, you know, your role is more important than this. Everyone has a role in the machine.
And it comes together and it meshes together.
Exactly.
That's how it has to work. And you know, my life has basically been simple. I mean, to me it's simple. Probably to some other people who have no experience with living in the country, let alone living on a farm. How busy and involved. And yes, there's ups and downs, you know, with having your animals and all the things that you see and you experience. And like I said, you have to love what you're doing, and you have to love Mother Earth. So when I go out and I weed my driveway, you'll never see me with gloves on. When I get all done, I got the dirt under my nails, go in, wash my hands, still there. Sometimes I get up and look in the morning, can't believe I got a couple of those dirty nails yet. It's only dirt.
This is something I'm learning, because when I went camping as a little girl, I used to cry and say, I don't want to put my feet in the dirt. Oh my God. You know, as sort of a city girl, okay? I mean, I'll say that. You know, people know me. You're living on a farm. But actually, in my own personal journey, everything that you're saying, I've come so far as I started becoming a yogi, I became more aware of this idea of waking up, like you said, on the tractor, starting every day with gratitude. And that's where it started for me. And now I wake up and I take off my shoes. You know, I'm wearing high heels. I'm going to take off my high heels for a moment. And I put my feet into the earth and I say, you know what? This is what gives to us. We better get familiar with it, huh?
And to go barefoot in the warm soil, you could, if you haven't done that, you don't know what you're missing.
Maybe we should do it together.
And I could tell you another story of something I did when I was a child, but I'm not sure I should tell you.
Will you walk over to the organic garden with me and maybe we can walk together in the soil?
When the soil warms up, it's got to be considerably warmer. I still got my heavy socks on.
Okay. So as a part of the larger, well, first of all, before I go into that, I feel great without my high heels on, guys. And thank you, Miss Marilyn, for reminding me how important it is to get your feet in the dirt. We're going to walk in the organic soil if it kills me. No, but that's another thing we'll share with the organic garden later. But part of this larger campaign, so there's a few components of the Rickey Farm Rescue, okay? Rickey Farm Rescue, Miracles in the Making, folks, is the larger overall campaign that is calling attention to all the various opportunities that we are cultivating here at Rickey Farm. That includes the venue, that includes the ministries, that includes the maple production, that includes the farming, it includes the hay, it includes a lot of other components, the community outreach. So the way that we want to facilitate making sure that all of those components of the Rickey Farm operation are brought into this next generation and generations to come is by turning over the property into the Rickey Farm Ministry name. So Rickey Farm Ministries is a nonprofit tax-deductible organization. And what that means for you folks that aren't so familiar with the business world is that as a nonprofit, the Rickey Farm Ministries will take over the ownership of the land. And that means it will be for the benefit of the community, for public benefit, for the public forever. Now, in doing that, what essentially has to happen is that the ministries can't buy out that property until the debt is paid off. Is that correct?
Probably.
Is that?
Probably.
Chase Bank has made a way for us to, they've made the offer for us to buy the property back.
Okay.
Chase Bank has made the offer for us to buy the property back.
To buy her house back?
Yes.
Okay.
To buy mom's house back. They currently, yeah.
To include it as a part of the Rickey Farm.
Because the foreclosure sale went through, but they've, right.
Okay. So, what we've learned here today is that Miss Marilyn, mom's home is an integral part of the Rickey Farm operation. It is the place from which all endeavors are born. It is the place from which our spirit as an operation and organization continues to grow and be nurtured from her love. And so it is crucial, it is critical that mom's house remains a part of the Rickey Farm operation for generations to come. And the way that that's going to happen is that Chase Bank has made a generous offer for us to be able to buy back Miss Marilyn's property. But they've given us a very, very short window of time to do so. And we are calling for everyone. We have less than 20 days to raise this money, to save Miss Marilyn's home, to buy back the property from Chase Bank and put it into the name of the ministries so that her home is part of this property forever, and that she never has to worry that she, after years and years, we won't say how many years because we're not gonna call out her age, but for many, many years, she's put into this land, and it's time that she can sleep easy at night knowing that she doesn't have to worry that she's gonna lose it. So we're calling out to you, Chase Bank. We're calling out to our fellow supporters of organic farming, of family farms. This is a seventh generation family farm. Please, we need your help today. And, you know, for someone who works so hard, it must be a little bit difficult to ask for help.
It is. It is. I've never been in a place where I've needed to ask for help. I mean, we lots of times just made ends meet, but we were in a place where we didn't have to ask for help for ourselves, and yet we were in a place, if someone came our way and needed a helping hand, needed a place to stay, we were open to that. We were able to help those people. And matter of fact, right now, my son Jamie is involved with a drug rehab program. And we have helped a number of people over the years. Sometimes it worked out for their best interests, and sometimes it didn't. But if they needed a place to stay and a place at the table, we did what we could to help.
And that's been my experience here. Like I said, I've only been here for just a few short weeks. And I can say with full faith and full authenticity that, you know, I really feel welcomed as a part of this Rickey Farm family. And that's really streamlined down from Mom.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's streamlined down from Mom. Even though we don't get to interact all that much.
Yes.
I feel the love. I feel the love streamlining from you through Jamie, through your son, who you've supported as a farmer's mother. Farmer's wife, farmer's daughter, farmer's wife.
Yes.
Farmer's
yes.
mother.
Yes. Started with the farmer's daughter, and then it was the farmer's wife, a farmer's mother, and I just hope one day...
But you're the farmer. You're not just all those things.
Yeah. You know
she
what?
Is the farm. She's the farm.
I'm the farmerette, actually. I'm the farmerette. And, you know, I have said different times, if I actually get to retire, I should write a book. I can tell you the most interesting stories about my childhood growing up on the farm. And different ones have said to me, you should do that. I've never really had the time to do that. You know?
Well, maybe when we get your house paid off and you can sleep with ease, you'll have the time to write that book.
Yeah, there's my limousine is here, my chauffeur. That's my brother-in-law and my sister.
All right. Guys, thank you so much. Miss Marilyn.
Love you.
Mwah. I love you so much.
You're a sweetheart. You're a plus to the
Thank
place.
You.
And
Thank
those
you
are
so
the
much.
Kind of people that we need.
Well, like I said, you know, we don't get to interact all that much on a daily basis, but she comes in, she brings our food, and everyone knows Jenny Meatballs loves food. And I'm like, Miss Marilyn, it's so good to see you. We can't let her home go under, folks. Please. I am calling out to you, anyone who has an interest in organic farming, in music production, in maple syrup, in animals. If you're an animal lover, if you have family values, there is a miracle here that will call to you. So check out our list of miracles under the Rescue Rickey Farm campaign. Miracles in the making. They're happening. They are already happening, and we want you to be a part of it. Thanks, and take care.
Thank you.